Hello, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, lovers of chess. Today is July 18th, and at 3 o'clock, as usual, we start our chess show. Now, I was talking a lot about chess being part of a great arts, including, of course, painting, even architectures, music, of course. And today we have special guests, which is a very chess and artistic couple at the same time. One is a very well-known grandmaster from Romania, Mihail Marin, and his lovely wife, Maria Yugina. And we would like to start our program, first of all, greeting them. Hello. And start with Maria to showing her great paintings, great works of art, second to none. Okay, Maria, please let us see your fantastic art.
Thank you, Sasha. This is my last painting with the chessboard. This is a classic kind of cubist or maybe colorism, and I was making a photo with me and my husband, and I have a kind of inspiration for this painting, for this romantic painting. I have any idea about continuation. Yes, this story. Story, this long story about romantic chess.
And the story may go on for next 20, 30, who knows, many years, because it's endless story about chess and love and the paintings and the great arts, what you're doing. It's really fantastic. Is Mikhail inspiring you to write all these beautiful paintings?
Yes, and this very good help, because we find the position, body position
on the board also.
On the board, yes, and very good help.
Are you using any positions from Mikhail's book
or books? Generally, when she asks me about positions, she tells me more or less what she needs. Sometimes it can be something simple. I mean, I don't want a crowded chessboard. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the position should suggest something. I don't really start looking in my books. I just try to remember classical games. Many of them are somewhere in my books, my articles, probably. But I just suggest this one or this one, and usually we reach a consensus. But talking about this painting, I understood that being a photo model is not so easy. I mean, you don't just have to, you know. yes, because we were trying, and we thought about half an hour, and I was wearing a nice shirt, I mean, more elegant, not casual like this one. I had a hat, and I had, you know, to stay like this. She pulled me by the tie, and I had to look at her with such, you know, eyes. And again, it was some effort. So
tell me, when Maria is choosing the position for her paintings, is she using computer analysis of position?
Probably not. Computer analysis is not very interesting for me.
I mean, chess is
and classic game.
Chess is beautiful and wonderful beyond computers. I mean, I work a lot with these classical players. Right now, I'm writing about Spassky.
I work with classical chess boards, not with the computer, with the chess board and chess set. It's okay.
No, that's a luxury that I actually allow to myself only now that there is this, I don't know how to call it, crisis, the pandemic, whatever. And we don't travel anywhere. So I have more time for my articles. And can you imagine what it means to spend 2 weeks by playing Fishers, Larsens, Baskis games over the board. I mean, something I didn't do in, I don't know, in decades. I mean, so intensively. And then, okay, I choose my games. I classify them somehow. I check them with the computers. Computers not always understand. You need to push them a bit to understand that those guys were right. And then I write my article, of course, on the computer. But I don't remember when I last afforded to do that. I mean, just sit in the garden, in the shadow, with an old book and the chessboard, and you know, just
beautiful. Yes. No, since we moved now into chess, I would like to introduce my panel for today's show. We have FIDE Master, okay, by the name James Ide from California. And also we have International Master over the in chess by I don't forgot the name, it's distant chess correspondent chess unbeatable coach from Tampa, Florida, Michael Hofer. Welcome to our program. How are you, Michael, doing today? How are you, Jim?
Great, Sasha, thank you for inviting me.
Yes, it's my pleasure to have you all. And we have a lot of interesting things to discuss today. But before we are going to discuss anything, I just want to show you something peculiar. I want to show you one of the classic games by, one of them is by Grandmaster Yefim Geller. Not only he is from my hometown of Odessa, he is one, he never became world champion, as we all know. However, he has a plus score with almost all world champions, including Fischer and Tao and Petrosyan and Botvinnik, and just name it. I think he has equal score probably with Spassky, because Spassky had beaten him badly in both candidate cycles in 65 and 68. And Spassky was, at that time, he was very difficult opponent for Geller, but Geller did very well prior to that. So I think, as much as I remember, they have about equal score, but all other world champions had great difficulties to play Geller. Now I want to show you his game, which he played with the white pieces in a, with a great ex-world champion, Vasily Smyslov, and it wasn't anything but friendly game. They played in the candidate matches, and okay, here's the game. Okay, let me not do a lot of talking, let game speak by for itself. So here's how the game goes. Geller played d4, and Smyslov plays very aggressive opening, which is a Grünfeld defense. And he played a variation which actually has his own name, the Smyslov variation in the Grünfeld defense. So we cannot criticize the opening as far as I can see. So far, it's basically more or less theory. Our resistance is an interesting idea. Normally, White used to play h3, and Geller figured out that most likely Smyslov is not going to play bishop g4, and he omitted h3 move and played f4 right away, and he was right. Smyslov didn't play bishop g4, wanted to have a more complicated game because of the match situation at the point Geller was ahead. So he wanted to have more complicated structure. But here Geller goes for attack himself, which is quite unexpected for Smyslov. And here White has tremendous initiative. And, well, what Smyslov makes actually all very natural moves. He's trying to create his own chances, using bishop b7 and queen c6 now. However, here is a very strong move. Look, rook defends g2 pawn, and at the same time creates space for another rook, move to f1.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, please, anybody, if you have some any comments, please interrupt me. Feel free, because I don't want to sound as I'm an expert in this position. I'm not. But I looked at Kasparov's comments before this program, and look at the game a little bit. It's quite fascinating, really, what's happening.
Well, if you look at
can I say a few words about this line?
Yeah. Black cannot afford to exchange a black squared bishop, so he must play bishop h8, which is expected. And here, yeah, did you expect this move, bishop queen f4?
No.
No. Okay, he plays rook d7 because sooner or later he must somehow cover his seventh line. And you see now.
Oh, I see the threat here.
Yeah, look at another piece now going into attack. Now, if you see, all white's pieces are in attack against king, of black's king, and another rook from c1, sooner or later it will come to f1. So it is, maybe at this moment, positions, black's position is probably at either much worse or maybe already lost. Smyslov plays here c4. Now, Kasparov criticizes this move. It's a natural move, but Kasparov criticizes it because it kills any chances for counterplay to take d4 or so on. So, obviously, next move is very simple. And now, rook goes to e7. So, Black is trying his best to create counter chances. Now, all his pieces except knight on a5 is a little bit tragic, according to Taras. It's not
knight
very well
placed.
Yeah. But other pieces are very well placed. So far, it looks like the Black may be able to defend it. Finally, what I said before, the last rook also going into attack. And here, very interesting move. Black takes on e4. So now if pawn takes on g6, then Black has queen g6, and maybe he could call. But instead, Giller is very quickly plays this. Now, this is a first queen sacrifice. It's not really a sacrifice because there is a checkmate in one. Rook takes queen, and pawn takes on h7, it's checkmate. So I would be called sacrifice. Although, it's technically, yes, it is. Black plays f6. Now, even strong computers were looking at moves queen f5 or queen g3. Not Giller. Giller is playing queen g5. Oh, ouch. No. Obviously, cannot take a queen because rook f8 and checkmate in 2. Okay? So, what to do? Okay. He covers now 7th rank. And looks like it's in a game. So now the most natural move would have been rook takes f6. But there are some threats later on after exchanges on the first rank for these ideas of a checkmating white king. So look at the next move. The game is extra sharp, very tactical, a lot of pieces in game. And here's the next move of Yefim Petrovich Geller. King g1.
I never thought of it. It never even occurred to me.
I would never guess this move. And now Black, maybe. What about taking the queen? No, because checkmate in 2 on f8.
Right.
So what to do now? So there is nothing else to do. Bishop g7. Finally, rook takes f6. Only now. Rook takes g4. However, here is what follows. And guess what's now? Check.
Right.
And sacrifice number 4.
Wow.
Queen takes queen, rook f8, and checkmate. Black resigned. So what's your impression of this game?
Marvelous.
Thank you. Yes, it is a classic game. Mikhail, what do you think about this game?
I have a few remarks to make. I mean, okay, no, the game is wonderful, but it's beyond doubt. First of all, this system is very complicated, this whole plan with F4. For instance, Spassky beat Fischer twice before their 72 match. And in both games, looked as if Fischer got this counterplay in the center and the queen side. But it's very tricky because sometimes his black's counterplay does not let's say, touch white's plan. White has his own plan, and they don't interfere so clearly. And white is attacking against the king, while black is attacking an empty or almost empty wing. So, this was the situation here too. Of course, it was by far more complicated, more tactical. And the second moment, remember the moment rook takes e4, f takes g6. I have been participating in a few important competitions, solving competitions. And there we have this mate in 2, mate in 3. there is a thing called five organs. It means that white threatens something, and then black tries to close some diagonals or files to defend, but he opens other ones. So it was nice that, okay, rook takes b4, and now, okay, fg doesn't threaten h on h7 because the diagonal is closed, but he has to take on f4. I mean, okay, if he takes on f4, then he closes the f file, then the diagonal gets open. So it's this mate on h7.
Yes.
So it has some study elements. Okay, with all the pieces on board almost, but and of course queen g5 and king g1. Okay, what can I say?
This game for the painting.
Yes.
Yes. Bravo. Well said. No. Yes.
I have one comment to make, and that is when I grew up as part of the Fischer boom in the United States, and Geller was one of the players that we admired the most because he did have a winning record and his games were spectacular to us. But I wonder if the generations that followed think of Geller the way that I thought of Geller. I wonder if his reputation has suffered over the years. He's not as appreciated as much as he should be.
It's quite obvious. I've looked at, in the last couple of days, I've looked many Geller's games, including those games against world champions. And it's 100% that we're going to have a special program about Geller and some of his games, especially against world champions. And obviously, I think Geller is still appreciated for essentially finding new ways, very innovative ways of playing all King's Indian defense, and even Botvinnik and some very strong players, even Petrosyan too, they couldn't crack Geller's method of playing King's Indian defense. And I think Fischer probably studied a few Geller games. I think he had to because the score was not that great against Geller. So we'll definitely look some of his games in the near future.
What do you think?
You know, I don't know exactly what each generation thinks. And of course, okay, you may suspect that Sasha is subjective because he was born in Odessa like Geller and is closer in generation with him. So I'm a completely different generation, but I consider Geller one of the deepest players ever. His practical strength was somewhat marred by the fact that he wanted to discover the truth over the board. And sometimes he would think 1 hour, 1.5 hours on a move, and he would see and understand everything. But then he would not have the time and the physical strength to finish the game logically.
That's right.
So
you may say that because of that, his time management, okay, so he was not, first of all, he didn't become a world champion, and he didn't really progress and have his due winnings because of that problem with time management. But even though he was extremely strong practical player, and he had fantastic result.
Okay, he was a permanent candidate. I mean,
many times.
But you know, I allowed myself to use somehow Botvinnik's criteria. Botvinnik, for instance, wrote about Petrosian that he had this inner talent to understand. He had an algorithm. He understood which piece doesn't stand well, and he just improved the. He didn't calculate. He just understood that the piece wants to go to that square. So this Botvinnik writes that Petrosian limited himself, didn't go higher because you know, it was comfortable. He didn't need to work for it. It was simple. Okay, but you're talking about a world champion who, after losing the title, he was still a candidate four more times. Okay, almost until the year he died. But for Botvinnik, it was not important that Petrosian was a world champion, that he was one of the strongest players in the world. In the history. No, he related to Petrosian from the point of view of what he could have become. I mean, I said the thing about Gerard. Of course, he was a fantastic player. But, for instance, Karpov, I analyzed a lot of Karpov and understood that one of his strengths was that the fact that he was a player. I mean, he had a perfect talent and understanding and will to play, yes, but he was the kind of guy who would not really look for the truth, neither during the game nor in the analysis. He would see a plan.
Yes.
And to his heart. He would calculate a bit and he would say, okay, this will work. And it usually worked because he was not bluffing. He had the means to sustain that plan completely. Yes. But this is why he defeated Korchnoi three times in the matches.
Yes.
You know, it was much deeper, but he was closer to Gellar a bit. He was creating things. But he was by 20 years older than Karpov. And he could not manage the time because he was looking for something. And Karpov was just playing what he felt. Okay, Korchnoi's talent was lower than Karpov's. So this is why he had to work. And with Gellar the same, he was a scientist. He was first of all a scientist and only then a player. I think this is what kept his results a bit lower than they should have been.
You made a point that's fascinating to me. I'm sorry, Sasha, if I can just...
No, please continue.
Oh, thank you. And I just thought that when I play over Geller's games, there's no indication of how much time he has left. And I wonder if that should be in our books, in our games, to let the players know, okay, here he has plenty of time, and all of a sudden here, he has less time because he spent so much time on this particular move.
Well, I think the only player, to my knowledge, who kept always a time left was David Bronstein. In his scores, he always had how much time left. But maybe some others did too. Michael, what do you think about Geller's contribution to chess as a game?
Well, I had a comment I wanted to make about the game. The game was lost because of the weaknesses in F8, and the two moves that got Smyslov in trouble were normal moves of centralizing your rooks. Rook FE8, which has been improved on by Dvoris. Black actually has won from that position on move 17. If you look in your database, it flashed up on the screen with c takes d4. And then the losing move was probably rook AD8 when he needed to play queen D6 to cover the dark squares there. So it's just unusual because normally when you see whenever a grandmaster whenever there's an open file, a grandmaster usually puts a rook on it because it's almost never wrong. But this was remarkable that the two moves that got Smyslov in trouble were rook FE8 and rook AD8.
And very natural moves.
Yeah. After that.
Well, Michael, I agree with your comments. However, let's give due to brilliant and very inventive and very aggressive game by Geller, number one. Number two, don't forget that although Smyslov erred in this game a couple of times here and there, but overall, Smyslov is one of the grandmasters, world champions, who made very few errors, like noticeable errors in his games. And I remember one many years ago, there was a study by computer of games of the world champions who had fewer errors, like really visible errors. And it was Capablanca who had fewer errors than anybody else. And also Karpov and Smyslov had very few errors. They had, of course, but fewer than others. And Capablanca had very, very few errors. Of course, he was losing the games. He lost much against Golovkin. But generally speaking, if you take all his games and look for errors, like visible errors, he had very few, really. Okay, however, let me continue what I've prepared for you, because we can talk about Geller probably next 7.5 hours.
We need a whole show for Hank Geller.
We will, nothing to worry about. What I want to do, okay, now I have to do share screen. Top share. Okay, chess stars and share. Okay, I've mastered that. Now you can see the chessboard.
Yes, all right.
Okay, now I want to tell you the game which was played a couple of weeks ago in one of this Carlson tournaments. Sorry, I'm going to use the latest issue of New in Chess magazine, which I just got yesterday. And here is the game. It's a Carlson played white, and Anish Giri played with the black pieces. You will see completely different chess. Now, get ready.
Okay.
D4, knight f6. So far, it's the same as Geller-Smyslov, right?
Right.
C4. Okay, now Giri plays e6, obviously much more solid opening.
That's what I play.
Looks like it. Knight f3, d5. Knight c3. So far, theory, nothing unusual. Now, bishop b4.
So it's a Rogozin.
Okay, Giri deviates from more solid lines, but bishop b4 has been tested quite a lot. Now, exchange. And now, Carlson played bishop b4. At this moment, we don't know, but few moves later, it's all computer preparation 100%, and I will show you why. So far, it doesn't seem to be so. Knight e4, rook c1.
Still normal.
Still normal, right? And this is also normal, right? Okay. Now.
I wouldn't call knight d2 normal somehow.
Yes.
Okay. If you don't call knight d2 normal, then how would you call g5 move?
Exclam question mark.
No, but after knight d2, g5 makes some sense. I mean, white started neglecting his development, so black.
When Carlson played knight d2, obviously he had to know g5 and what's going to next. But so far, let's just watch the game. Bishop e3. Keeps the pressure. And here we have a couple of exchanges. Knight takes c3. And bishop h3. Wins the tempo. Rook goes to b1.
Right.
Here, black is trying to use the weakness of bishop on e3 by playing f5. Shouldn't be unexpected for Carlson, because it is quite natural move. The threat is now f4. Right. So, you know, white has to really do something against it. Okay.
You're going to tell me this is all computer analysis they're playing.
Well, at this moment, I'm not convinced, really, because it may be very deep preparation of the line. Okay, g3 obviously prevents f4, okay? And now black bishop on h3 is quite useless. So by relocating it to d6, now obviously you're threatening f4.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense.
Okay, at this point again. Okay, so here's a game, normal game, and, it's quite a very sharp position, a lot of possibilities. And I try to guess what white played in this position, what makes me to believe that it's all computer preparation on both sides.
Okay, then you confuse me, because I would think F3 or something like that.
Right. Michael, what would you play here?
I am not sure.
Mikhail, any ideas?
No, I would, of course, the natural move is knight F3, but then you lose a lot of tempi. F4, it looks, so it should be something to sacrifice the bishop on E3. Attack D5 somehow.
Okay, here is maybe what Carlsen played and why I believe it's all computer preparation. How about this move?
Ah, rook G1.
Wow.
Yeah, that never would have occurred to me.
absolutely now. Anush Giri brings a lot of variations here. I don't want to really spend time on all these variations. Right. What I'll show you that he played the most natural move in this position, which is castle. It's a very simple move. The F4 is being amplified now.
But castling with the rook on putting the king on the g-file with the rook on g1, somehow it offers white tempo, because now F4 is not a threat anymore.
Yeah, that's true. However, look up more moves. A Carlsen plays h4.
Of course, yeah.
And look, Giri found, or his computer found, a very interesting sequence of moves. G4, F4. Pawn takes. And here, G4. And after... Now, don't forget that pawn is protected by bishop on C8. And after, black will play, sooner or later, H5. This pawn on g4 is very well protected. With the white position, it's even unclear how to finish its development and like what to play. So in this position, Carlsen makes now move rook d5. So he attacks at d5 and maybe with the idea to takes on d5 and maybe even exchange to sacrifice his material on the exchange on d6, maybe, just maybe. Here is very cool answer by Giri, knight e7. Protects pawn on d5, and he's threatening to play sooner or later c6, chasing the rook, and f5 now is very much under black control. And here, Carlsen is trying a furious attack, f5. He wants to relocate the bishop on g5 and finish his development, because it's unclear what else to do. And here he plays h5, wow, ignoring everything, but to fortify his pawn on g4, which is very, very important issue in this game. Okay, so in this position, Carlsen is playing bishop g5, following his plan to finish the development. The pin on knight of e7. Giri plays c6, chasing the rook and protecting d5 pawn. Rook b2. And rook f5. Obviously preparing in the view of white playing e4. He's preparing very clever sacrifice. G5.
Oh.
Now, this Giri is writing that this was a pre-move. So, he, obviously, Magnus was expecting rook takes G5. And here, Giri plays knight G6. And probably this position is already somewhat better for black, because not that he has really tremendous advantage, it's just looks like easier to play with the black pieces this position, because with the king in the center, very unclear how to really continue with white this position. So Carlton play e5.
That makes sense.
Yeah, very simple move, bishop f8. And here, Magnus playing bishop g3, also logical move to finish development, attacking knight on g6.
But it's asking for it to go to f4.
Yes, knight moves to f4, absolutely correct. Knight f1, protecting the bishop.
Right.
That's a mistake.
Queen takes g5. See, now with every move, black is increasing his dynamic position. Now yeah. He has two bishops. He has a very strong pawn on d4, h5, very strong queenside pawns. So, and here Carlsen makes quite an expected move, f3. He's still trying to build an attack, maybe to bring his rook from b2 to g, maybe h5 or so on. However, what he didn't see is that knight takes bishop, queen takes, queen c1 check.
Oh, I didn't see that either.
Yeah, king f2, check,
knight
g2. And very simple move, bishop f5.
Yes, very simple and forcing.
Game is over because he must stay. Now check. In g3. Very cool move. Because there is no really checks. Because there are two checks. Queen g6, bishop g7, queen e6 checking, h8. That's it. And you can start with queen e6, will be the same thing. So Carlsen is playing king h4. Another simple move.
Wow.
Four. It's, now it's becoming a marker. Bishop g7. F4. And very simple move. Rook f8. And Carlsen resigned. In this
yes. Place.
Any comments about this game?
It surprised me at several instances, so it did not look like a classical game to me in any sense of the word. And I don't know where to criticize White's play, but it did seem at some point White must have gone very wrong. Because Black's position went from maybe a little better to very much better. And I'm not okay. Sure exactly where.
Okay, Michael, what about you?
Yeah, it was when he didn't withdraw the light squared bishop to b1. He had two occasions where he should have done that, and letting the knight just take the bishop at d3 was a losing move. I also think that Bob's move on move 13, knight f3, is far superior to Carlsen's Rook G1. I think Rook G1 was an extraordinary move, but I don't think it was the best move by any means. I think Bob was on the right path with knight f3.
Yes, okay, Mikhail, please, Grandmaster's opinion.
Well, what can I say? This kind of fight where each move, each side move comes as a surprise. It's not something, okay, I assume that there was a long phase which was both players' home analysis. And then some of them, I don't know, maybe he just stopped and actually they went deeper. But, you know, I have now in mind a game, Knack, Bronstein. Where it was starting with move 12 or so, okay, they were out of field. Now, no doubt that they were just playing on the ball. And it was a long phase where it moved seemed to change the evaluation. First, you see White play something okay, he gets an attack. Then Black answer. Suddenly, you don't feel so secure with White. Then White makes the move, and again. So it just goes like this. So this was a very high conceptual chess. There are also other games, but this is one of those I remember best. this first phase of the game, Valkyria, of course, was very interesting. But again, we can only suppose how much it was fruit of their own mind and how much of the computer. So
I agree with Michael's talk, because it seemed to me that Bishop B1 was indicated, and what when it was not played, it seemed to go from bad to worse. But from my point of view, the thing that I would say is it didn't look like a game that I would have ever played or been involved in from white or black. The moves that they were playing were very surprising to me. And there was an ebb and flow back and forth through it, which was entertaining. But it wasn't a game that I understood well.
Mm-hmm. Well, to me, Rook G1 move is a number one indication that it was all computer preparation by both players, because looks like position was studied by both players, and it's a result of a very deep computer preparation. However, when this preparation was over and they started to play their own moves, the quality of the game deteriorated, especially from Magnus' point of view, because when he allowed knight f4 and knight take d3, specifically knight d3, I think that was a turning point, after which there was no defense. So basically, if you take out computer preparations, there were very few moves that were played actually by both players, so-called over the board, because obviously they played online. And at the point when they start to play their own moves, the game was actually over in five or six moves. That's my impression of the game.
But this game not for the study chess, because I was a chess teacher, and I don't understand why I show this game for the children. It's I don't know. Not for the study.
Would you show your
painting?
Would you show your students' game of Geller Smyslov, the first one?
I don't remember, but of course now I show.
I will show.
Yeah, but I don't remember because I don't remember anything.
But it was a very instructive game from my point of view, whereas this one was not. I took away no lesson.
No, but well, I mean, if you just showed me the game, Carlton Giri, I would have classified it together with this Knack Bronstein and other games, which is a very good exercise, but not for children, of course. I wouldn't show it to Maria's former pupils. But if you want to be a grandmaster, or if you are a grandmaster and want to improve, that put us an exercise, because each move comes as a surprise and seems to change the evaluation of the position, which is not possible, because actually the truth is only one. The evaluation can be only one if both players play correctly. But of course, we'll never know how much they produce with their own minds. And for these reasons, I prefer to study the classic, because I know that what I see on the board and the comments, that was them. And I admire the strength of mine.
Sasha, Geller's game would have been in this book, but the Carlson's game would not be.
Do you consider Smyslov to be a dummy?
No, I thought it was very instructive. So neither was a dummy.
But
Mike, SG's theory. This was a chess.com tournament, and 6 days earlier, the same exact position, Carlson had beaten Faruja, he castled. Giri played bishop d6, that was the new move, and perhaps Carlson was anticipating Giri might do that, and maybe that's why, that's actually support that Rook G1 very likely could have been preparation, because Carlson probably... And having just played the same variation 6 days earlier, that makes sense. But still, I think Bob's move, knight f3, is better. But that would also explain why Carlson would play rook g1 to surprise Giri.
Yeah, I think so. You know, look, I'm not a specialist in computer preparation by any means. It feels to me that when computer goes really, really deep into position, and if computer shows the line that black has a chance to either simplify or somehow to get even position, then that's not acceptable for Carlson. For example, so he looks for another line. So in another line, maybe also simplifies and maybe also black equalize. So now he would look at rook g1. And even if rook g1 is not simplifying so quickly, then the position remains more complicated, or a way to acquire it is more complicated. So that would be the reason to choose rook g1 rather than maybe knight f3 and maybe some other moves. So I think this is a part of computer preparation. But the downside, in my opinion, is that Geary, he played all his moves, the castle, the idea f, g4. They were all very natural, classical, positional moves, in fact. I really don't see a lot of originality in Geary play. He played all very solid, natural moves, and he defeated Carlson, probably by far the strongest players in the world, by playing natural moves. How would you explain that, Mikhail?
Well, you know, there is this aspect, because, okay, all the top players and grandmasters, they analyze with the computers when they prepare. There is no time for looking on the board. Okay, what was this? This is our question, no? We have this strong computer which are just hitting up like this, and we go forward. Yes, but, you know, the mind, the human mind remains the same. Or maybe it goes down because it doesn't think independently so much. So you reach the position the computer told you it's good for you. And then you are suddenly alone. And there is no computer around. Make a move. And maybe the position is too hard to understand for, maybe the computer would win that position. But you are alone now. So I would compare this with talking about Geller. You know, the second, the grandmaster who helped Spassky becoming the world champion was Bondarevsky. Then before the match with the Fischer, Spassky fired him. Even though it's not clear if Bondarevsky didn't resign first. Okay, they argued, they had a big argument, and they is.
Well, but you remember Bondarevsky thought that Spassky is too lazy. And that's why Spassky fired him, and Geller got involved.
Yeah, okay, Geller was very deep. As an analyst, he was the best Spassky could get. But Spassky was so lazy that he didn't remember or he didn't trust this queen b7. He played a queen's gambit against Fischer. And Fischer played some bishop b5, which was a rare move. It had been played only once. And Geller had refuted it.
Queen b7.
Queen b7 and Spassky. So why do you have a second like Geller? if you are not, I mean, you know, if you are not in the state of mind to understand what the guy is preaching to you. And okay, there is a second aspect that Fischer understood that he's in danger because of Geller. And he started, running like this in zigzag through the repertoire. And they would only catch him twice in the fourth and 11th game. Okay, the fourth game Fischer saved. Yes, so why do you need Geller against Fischer? No, you need Bondarevsky to tell you that you are stupid, that you have to work, that you, whatever, you know. This was a mistake. Okay, no, basically speaking, I don't think, fortunately, I said it clearly. Nobody can stop people. But okay, if you want to play some decent match, then you don't fire Bondarevsky. Only because he, no, I know that Karpov took part at the last final phase of the training camp. For Reykjavik, and he said, "Look, I Karpov, I know I'm lazy. I have been lazy all my life, but I never thought that somebody could be so as lazy as Spassky because of everything."
Yeah, but you remember, Mikhail, I remember that Spassky had a theory of a clean head. He believes that he does not need preparation as long as his head is clear, his mind is clear, he can defeat anybody. And remember when he played a match against Korchnoi in 1968, yes. And he won the match, and after that he defeated the person. So when correspondent asked Korchnoi, he asked Pasky, what is the reason that you beat Korchnoi? How it happened? And Spassky replied, because Korchnoi had his wife during the match, and I had two young blondes. Now you can figure out why I won the match. Remember that.
Yes, but you know, I once interviewed Portish a few years ago, and Portish was, of course, a great player. He was eight-time candidate, and he had two matches with Spassky. One he won, and the one he lost. And he said that when he lost to Spassky, he made a mistake. Probably the Hungarian Federation supported him very much financially. And instead of 1 second, he had 3 seconds. Not 2 points, but 3 seconds. And the seconds, instead of building up a team to help the guy, they competed between them. You know, they wanted to. And the match was a disaster. So. But yes, referring to the computer, yes. I mean, you have to analyze something up to a point that you can be sure that you can understand the position and play over the board. Because, you look back, you are on a ship. You look back, you see Mother Fritz on the shore waving at you. But you cannot hear what the moves he's suggesting anymore. So you are on your own in the ocean. So if the ocean is like this, you have to be sure that you can swim in that kind of water. So, otherwise, you prove your preparation, you are winning, and you lose.
You see, now I'm thinking a lot about impact on chess lovers, students of the game, the games of the classical chess. One game of Geller's that I showed you, but there are many, many, many other games that we already seen or could see, and for some reason they're very beautiful games. They're also educational games for young students that you can something explain, they can something to learn this, and most importantly, they can enjoy these games. If you look at the games of today, which are 80% probably, if not more, is computer preparation, it's very difficult to use them for enjoyment or for learning something. Show your students so they could learn something. It's just, it's like if you take a human soul, and if you take soul out of your body, it doesn't make any sense at all. And in the meantime, that computer preparation is taking soul out of chest. It's a chest, but there is no soul. There's no substance in it. There's no artistic value. There is really nothing left. So the question is, we have to probably recognize, again, I will provide analogy with art, especially music, because music is very close to me for many reasons. Music, classical music, let's talk about classical music for a sec. It went through about 300 some years of great development, and it's a great line of German composers, which is a backbone of the classical music. We are talking about Bach, Beethoven, obviously Wagner, and Richard Strauss, okay? So this is the backbone of classical music, and then you have other great composers, whether it's Chopin or Tchaikovsky or some others. There are many others. Now, by the time that Richard Strauss was still composing, there was a feel that all this classical music, I mean, it's not going anywhere. We need now some new music, some 12-tonal music, atonal music. And we had several composers who were creating very interesting musical pieces, but compared to classical composers like Bach and Beethoven and so on, it was very artificial, and but it's quite explainable that if you take the backbone of music, it's the musical tones, just coming from all the church music and developing, you will see that it's based on the tones and the overtones and so on. And the new music, it went so far away from ability of human ear to appreciate the classical music that it started to make no sense. Who knows, maybe chess has the same capacity to let us enjoy up to a certain point. And if you are going into machine-like chess and go computer and study farther and farther, you are leaving a sphere of human understanding of chess, enjoyment of chess, using chess for educational purposes. So being defeated is taken out of the game. A soul of chess is no longer there. That's what I meant there's some sounds coming in.
But it's okay, Sasha. I think you're taking the soul out of it. You're talking about that in composing music as well as in chess, so that it is no longer has the power to make men happy. If you're
agree.
Playing.
Agree. Absolutely agree with you, Saint Jim. Absolutely agree with you. Now, whether the chess is dead, which is title of today's program, as we look at the chess right now, we don't know what's going to happen in a few months, a year from now. Hopefully things will change, it will improve. Now, the chess over the board is being killed for all practical purposes. There are no tournaments, no Olympiads, really nothing even to talk about. However, even before coronavirus calamity, there were two matches for the world championship. One produced 12 games, 12 draws. Two years prior to that, 12 games, 10 draws. Do we want to see such a game when result is predictable, almost 100%. As creation of whatever beauty they might be, you need a microscope to uncover the beauty. So next to impossible. Okay. So what is left? The online chat. It's infected with cheating. In fact, there is more cheating than ever before. Whoever claims that they found a remedy from cheating, all this chess.com and chess.com and so on, it's impossible phenomena to deal with. And our expert in computer programming, Marty Hirsch, he assured me that in the next 75 years, there will be no remedy found on the internet. So that part of chess is gone. The example that chess could possibly follow is the poker. Poker became very, very big on television and internet everywhere because there is an element of gambling. There is every year a new world champion, so there is no predictability. In chess, let's say my rating is say 2200, I will play 2500, I will lose 5 out of 5. No brainer. I will play, say, 1900 or 1800 player. Who knows if he's going to use engine, then he will be hit me 4 or 5 out of 5. 5 out of 5. Yes. Okay. So there's no such thing as a playing online. There's nothing. So what I'm preparing now very deep material on a form of chess, which I would call a democratic chess. It's a level playing field. Everyone has a chance to win. Your chances to win are based on your understanding of the game, your ability to predict a move by strong grandmasters, not machines, not computers, but real grandmasters playing over the board, so-called over the board. Although if this coronavirus story will end hopefully soon, hopefully, maybe we will have over the board games instead of on internet. And what I would like to select is the 64 grandmasters who will be playing hopefully over the board, if not over the board, then online games where you can learn from, where you can enjoy, that there will be human games and you can predict the moves and win sizable prizes. And I'm planning to have a first prize of up to $1 million. Now, for a chess enthusiast, a possibility to win $500,000 probably. And if everything will go well, then we will see $1 million as well. So, but I want to start with $5 million. And in this situation, I think that's the future for chess. Grandmasters will be able to show their skills in a real, over the board, non computerized human games, so people can enjoy them. People will have chance to win because there will be several other prizes, not just first prize, several other prizes. And I hope this system will become a popular among chess enthusiasts, chess lovers, grandmasters. And I'm preparing now material for investors who will most likely support this project. And we will have a real democratic chess model. I would be glad to hear any comments from you, gentlemen and lady.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm a huge fan of what you're proposing, and I would, invest in it. That's how much I'm convinced that you're onto something big here. And I would say I would go back. Because you and I can talk chess on a fairly equal footing, but you're far above me in classical music. But I preferred Bach, the Beethoven, because I could understand Bach, and the only way I could appreciate Beethoven was not to think about it because it was too complicated for me. And so this is what I see in the Carlsen game: is it's too hard for me to understand, so I don't appreciate it. And the classical games I can understand and I can appreciate. And what you're suggesting has this element of both. It's sort of like you're having the players play as human beings, not machines, and you're having the other human element of wagering on who's the better predictor. And I participated in this a couple of times, and unfortunately for me, Shirov was one of the players. And I was sure I was absolutely sure what Shirov's move would be, and he would play a move that I hadn't expected, hadn't considered, and I would lose all my crowns. So but to me, instead of just caring about the crowns, it was very entertaining, and I enjoyed myself.
And Michael, you played in many contests lately in the last couple of years. Tell me, what are your impressions about this?
Well, the thing I love about the contest is you're not choosing the best move, and guys like Danchenko intentionally don't play the best move. If I can tell you a quick story about an interaction I had with Vasily Smyslov in New York, something he did to me. I was waiting for him to draw a rook ending, as was Spassky, to get him to sign an original copy of rook endings by him and Levin Fish, which, as you've said, Sasha, Levin Fish really wrote it. But as they were getting ready to leave, Spassky goes, "No, you don't understand. We are on our way to Easter midnight mass at St. Patrick's." I said, "No, you don't understand." And I held up the book, and Smyslov went romp and scribbled in Cyrillic. Spassky signs beautiful Cyrillic autographs. Smyslov looked like a kid scribbled in the book. So they left. I went with my wife to the Hard Rock Cafe, and we got back at the same time. Smyslov was alone. And there was a woman in a raincoat that was clearly insane, bugging people in the streets. And I said to my wife, "Just watch, she'll go up to Smyslov next." And she did. He didn't know how to handle it. I told her to buzz off. So I had a little conversation with Smyslov. He says, "Where are you from?" "I'm from Florida." And he says, "Ah, and Denker too." which was funny to me. And then the next day I played the guy, right? Yeah, that's his geography, where Denker lived, because he beat Denker in the radio match. So yeah, that was his perspective. So the next day, I'm playing Smyslov. I'm killing him with a King's Indian Defense, about to rip his king side open with G4. And, you know, Joel Benjamin is standing behind Smyslov going like this, cheering me on. And Smyslov takes his knight, moves it to B5, slams it, screws it into the board, and smirks at me. And I'm thinking, wow, this guy was world champion when I was born. He doesn't have to resort to tactics like that. That must be a good move. So instead of ripping him open, I made a defensive move on the queen side, and next thing, his knight was dancing in my head. I resigned. Joel Benjamin thought I had won. He went like this, and I went, no. So I didn't understand what had happened to me until I finished a book called Psychology and Chess. And it said that Smyslov was known in the Soviet Union for the Smyslov screw, to intimidate people. So I learned a really great lesson from that. Never pay attention to the psychological garbage and how they move the pieces. Now, in the Choose Your Moves and Win contest, I think Donchenko just plays provocative moves all the time. It's very entertaining. So the psychology element is a big part of how you can win the contest. And you also have to win the contest by choosing unorthodox moves, moves that other people haven't picked. You got to be like the only winner or two guys in the pool. So that's what makes it really exciting, because it's not the best move. It's what the human's going to do. And that makes it far more fun for everyone and a level playing field for everyone, especially since you've got Stockfish on the screen.
Well, thank you both. Now, you always played on one side to being move predictors. Now, Mikhail, he was on the other side. He was the one whose moves we were trying to predict.
Right.
Mikhail, what's your impression of the contest as a player?
So generally, I feel very inspired each time I play. Okay, I face a strong opponent. Of course, I don't know. I cannot feel what happens on the other side of the wall. I mean, I twice or thrice, three times I participated to the contest, but it's somehow not for me. I mean, okay, playing is the real thing. But okay, it's a good feeling. You play against a strong player, and you know that a lot of people are waiting for your moves. You know, so I mean, in other tournaments, okay, I can count on my wife to follow me. Maybe my friend Valentin Stoica, international master, and a little okay, maybe two, three more persons at most. But on the contest, of course, you feel that, somewhere there are some eyes watching you.
Yes.
You don't see them, but they are there. Now, if I talk, of course, I feel the thrill of the gambling, but I'm not so good in gambling. I mean, okay, if you want me to analyze the game, then I can do it. But to predict, it's not my... my piece of cake. Of course, sometimes I can just say, oh, did it clearly, he had to do that, but in a relaxed mode. But now about the second part, the democratic system you mentioned of your project. Of course, more and more it has become a bit elitist. We have the same players, not so many playing among them. And I think... What happened during the last two world title matches, I considered it a shame, okay, for chess. But now with the coronavirus, I think that things became even worse. Why? Okay, first of all, they play only rapid and blue. It's not the same level, of course. But okay, you know, all the grandmasters now, they don't have tournaments. They have to live somehow. I'm not affected because I'm a writer, a trainer. Okay, I have my things. I'm playing chess as an amateur already. But okay, there are those professionals of low level who have problems finding work, no, finding tournament. these guys, 10, 12, how many they are, they are, of course, pivotal. Carlsen organizes these tournaments, which is a good thing, in principle, because it keeps the interest of everybody, sponsors and so on, alive. I don't deny that this is a good thing, that now there are tournaments and there is some impact. But okay, all the guys invited. I have tried to follow some games, but it happened many times. Okay, I remember a game in Lepomiachi against Giri. Maria just asked me, okay, what should we do here? Nepo was better. And I looked, I don't know, I was in a break from my writing activity or whatever. I don't, maybe drinking. I was in very relaxed. I said, okay, you know, if you sacrifice the exchange, I'm doing it. Actually, Maria asked me, what if 97? Yeah, 97 was Giri's move. And I said, okay, if he takes 97, sacrifice the exchange, I'm doing it. Giri plays 97. And Nepo, who had 7 or 8 minutes left, he plays instantly another move. And 3 moves later, it's a draw. I said, okay, well, I must be too weak. I checked with the computer, my rook c7 wins. I mean, but it's trivial somehow. And I saw many games like this where maybe it's also this gap. I mean, okay, they come very well prepared. They play well 15 moves, relatively well 20, 25 a bit weaker, and there is a disaster. So, you know, they know that now they work, they get some money, some easy money. I mean, they are the elite. Carlsen invites them. They smile like this to Carlsen. He invites them. They make good money for staying at home and handling them out. You know, it's not the same thing as during a tournament. You have to travel, to adapt yourself, to whatever, to have the pressure of the opponent on the other side of the ball, just 1 meter away from them. It's that moment, you know, with the mouth. I don't remember. I played something. Okay, I will play another tournament. So it's good. So I think that they don't display this, and the quality is quite low. I mean, even this blunder of Carlsen. I mean, he would not blunder that badly in a normal game. But I think that it became worse now. It's good that Carlsen makes the tournament, but somehow something is wrong with them. Somehow. And of course, the democratic system, of course, there would be many players, grandmasters who don't have tournaments nowadays, would just try to give the best of themselves. Okay, let's just hope that they will not give the best of their computers, that there will be no wires, no.
But you talked about having your eyeballs on you, and even though you couldn't see them, well, the advertisers would see them. And so instead of relying on a patron, or maybe a tatafil, instead of, you would be getting people interested in how many eyeballs do you have on this, and paying not only to have the tournament, but to pay the grandmasters to play. Mm-hmm. And so this would be a source of income for the grandmasters. So,
yes.
And I think that it's good for everybody. It's entertaining for me to be involved in it, where I am not so interested in following Caruana Carlsen. I'm interested in following you playing anybody that's around your level and trying to predict what you're going to play. It's entertaining. And so the wagering aside, you know, it's just fun for a player like myself who's not at your level, but who thinks that he might be able to predict what you're going to play in a certain situation. And I'm involved, I'm excited, and I'm interested, and my eyeballs are interesting to the advertisers. So I see this as working on many levels, and maybe not the aesthetic value of the games themselves. Maybe that will be missing, but the idea of excitement in chess, I think, is an add to all of our lives. If we can,
I remember a time when Michael Hofer won quite a lot of contests, including when Mikhail was playing, but other players. Michael, what was your recipe? How did you manage to win contests?
Yeah, I won $2,000 in 2 months on your site, which was pretty cool. That was very cool.
How did you do that?
I spent an extraordinary amount of work during the week compiling the players' repertoires and trying to predict what the openings were going to be on Saturday. Because back then we played on Saturdays and Sundays, and trying to understand the styles of the players. And I really feel like my friend Bob, I understand his style quite well, but he has been one of the most difficult guys for me to predict. Every so often he'll love shuffling rooks or he loves knight moves. And trying to predict his knight moves are pretty interesting. But I must say, since the Marine family has become together, I think Marie is creating beautiful art. And Bob, in the last couple of years, has become very aggressive and I think a much better player than he used to be. And he has been fantastic in the matches lately. So, you know, it's just, as he's a friend of mine, and I can't predict his moves. When I had students in a contest, I couldn't predict their moves. I think I did better those 2 months because you didn't have friends or people I know.
Yes. So what can I say? First of all, I believe that this new form of chess, I'm still working. I have to figure out quite a few details. For example, if I will have 128 qualifying tournaments and all winners, 128 people will make to a final, and there will be a first prize of $5 million and so on. But for that, I need 64 grandmasters. Because they will play two games each, but each game is a qualifying event for making a final. So I need 64 grandmasters who will start playing essentially eliminating matches. So in next round, there will be only 32 left and so on and on and on. And there will be several prizes for grandmasters from first level, second level, third level, and so on. The problem is quite arbitrary because I need selection of 64 not only strong grandmasters but also highly ethical grandmasters who will not cheat, who will not do all kind of things. And, Mikhail, we know together a few names in chess who are grandmasters but who I will not invite. For sure.
I think Michael knows them too.
Michael, you know some of them, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, we will not. So, obviously, I will need help of Mikhail to help me to select the right people.
And you can make them use webcams. You can make them use webcams so that they're not cheating.
We will use webcam. But I not only that, I want, if I have a choice between ethical grandmaster ethical grandmaster, I would rather go for ethical grandmaster, even with web cameras and any other precautions. Okay. Now, before we finish, any comments on the system that I'm offering to a chair?
Well, yeah. there are many details to work out.
Strong players are on it. Because, there is a thing that, chess can make you happy. And when you cheat, you do this.
Yes.
So there are, all these, there are some strong players who cheated. But this is more of an exception. I think that there is a bigger danger of cheating from, let's say, anonymous players. I mean, who just feel that it would be so cool to have 25, 26 hundred ratings.
Yes.
But I think that the most grandmasters, they could act incorrectly over the board. As Michael said, that's true. They look like this. But this is part of the fight. I mean, they accused Mikhail Talo for hypnotizing them.
All right. Yes.
The other guy, Benko, who played with sunglasses. Maria talks about women's décolleté. She knows that this is an effective weapon when playing with a man. So,
but it's all started, I think it's all started with Emmanuel Lasker, where he had cheap cigars and he was smoking the cheap cigars so the opponents couldn't play.
No, but I know another story about him. He was playing maybe Teichmann and he took out a big cigar. You know, good big cigar. And at some point, Teichmann said to the arbiter, he disturbs me. He should take the cigar away. And Lasker said, yes, but I didn't even light it up. Yes, but the threat is stronger than the threat.
That's a good story.
Okay. But there are, of course, some players go too far because of they are nervous or whatever. But cheaters, I wouldn't think there are so many cheaters, percentually, from the grandmasters, let's say.
I agree with you. And also, they would become known, and then they wouldn't be invited back. So they would be weeded out.
Yeah, but I think it's more like this. Not. They say that, what keeps a country, a nation correct is the rules, the punishment. But I believe that in chess, it's not only this. I believe that in chess, it's also the fact that you like to play chess. And you want to be...
Got the temptation.
He's got the execution, too.
but I didn't like it. I didn't like it. Maybe I will, but later.
That's a big cigar. What are you going to have to drink with that cigar?
I hope it's a Cohiba, yes?
Sorry?
I hope it's a Cohiba.
No, it's not, unfortunately. This is, it calls Havana Castle. It is like a Cuban cigar, but it's like Honduras. Really, really nice.
That's okay. Yeah.
In Honduras, they make very good, no? Yes. Dominican Republic. Very interesting cigars. Yes.
Yeah, they have some good. Yeah.
And so, are you going to pair it with the cognac or? Your mind, yeah.
No, whiskey.
Whiskey. Okay.
Yeah, this one goes with whiskey.
Okay.
You have to learn. You know, I remember a very good cruise I was a couple years ago on. I think it was Royal Caribbean. And they had a cigar room. Now, in the cigar room, you walk in, so they ask you, you want to select cigar first, and then we will select the right drink for the cigar. Or you want to select drink, and then we will find the right cigar for the drink. So you have to make selection, what comes first, cigar or drink?
Yes. I think that Spassky found the secret.
yes, for sure.
Yeah. Could I ask Maria a question?
Please do.
I think your paintings are really cool. They're becoming the rage in the chess world. And I would like to know, if a chess aficionado asked you to make a specific painting, would you do that for them?
Yes,
Maria. As long as it is not
many orders, and for example, I was make Batet's sisters, the double portrait. And,
you know, Alexandra Batet and her sister.
Yes.
They are famous on
for us friend Baby Armash. Some small, very small painting.
But also, okay, you have paintings with me and Jakub Agard.
Jakub.
Yeah,
me and Jakub Agard, and also this Carol Lala with two guys wanted paintings where they are with Carlton.
Right.
And one guy with the wife, just one guy. With wife, because another guy only with Carlson and one guy with wife.
Yes, there's some English guy so nice. Who wanted his wife is a cello player. Cello, I believe. Okay, doesn't matter. So Maria portrayed them on the stage. One of them is playing chess and the other one is playing the cello. So. No, and also you also had, yes, but this was the only one who wanted himself in the painting with the wife. The others wanted Carlton.
Yes.
Even wanted me. Can you imagine how desperate some people are?
But if you can paint me playing chess and make me look handsome, it would be worth something for me.
Maria, I have for you a better answer to Michael's question. You know what is it? I will do it as long as it is not the last city of Pompeii?
We didn't hear you.
Yes. Okay. Michael asked the question if you will make a special painting which you would order the theme. Can you do it? My answer to the question would be yes, I do. I will, as long as it is not the last day of campaign. I would do something like that.
You have some boundaries. You have to say, I will do this, but I will not do that.
Yeah, I have a very good friend of mine. He is not a big expert in arts. And when we went to Europe and we went to different museums and so on, we looked at impressionists in Paris and so on. And he said that I'm not too impressed with all that. I recognize only two paintings. One is The Last Day of Pompeii, and another one is Ivan the Terrible kills his son. That's the only two paintings what he appreciates.
Yeah, to each his own. It's all a question of taste.
Maria, it was nice. Ivan Grozny убивает своего сына.
I know, of course. Yeah.
That's type of painting what he likes. Very tragic.
But Sasha, I wish you so much success in your endeavor in this exercise, because I think it would bring a lot of enjoyment to a lot of people. And it has the power to make people happy. And that's what your proposal is all about.
Thank you so much. And I hope we will all benefit from it. And I hope we will all enjoy it as well. Thank you very much for a wonderful program today. Thank you so much. And hope we will meet soon again.
Me all too.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Sasha. Good luck. And thank you, everybody, for following us.
Good to see you, Bob and Maria.
Michael, thank you, Jim.
Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.